Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be your kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And assembled in Trinity Cathedral, Easton, Maryland, on Saturday, June 11, 2016. The Right Reverend Santosh Marray, Bishop-elect, being at least 30 years of age, was duly elected by a constitutional majority consistent with the Constitution and canons of the Diocese of Easton, and that all requirements of the Constitution of the Episcopal Church have been complied with. In witness whereof, we, the Right Reverend Henry Nutt Parsley, Jr., D.D., President of the said convention, and Ms. Nancy M. Dick, Secretary thereof, have hereunto set our hands and caused the seal of the diocese to be affixed this 11th day of June, 2016. Signed, Henry Parsley, President of Convention, Nancy Dick, Secretary of Convention. Addendum to the testimonial of election. The testimonial of election assumes that the person elected is to be ordained to the episcopate. In this instance, Santosh Marray is already a bishop of the church. Thus, this testimonial is understood to refer to Bishop Marray's election to accede to the office of Bishop Diocesan of the Diocese of Easton, dated June 14, 2016, signed Kevin M. Cross, President of the Standing Committee, Nancy M. Dick, Secretary of Convention.
Canonical testimonial of election. We, whose names are hereunder fully written, fully sensible of how important it is that the sacred order and office of a bishop should not be unworthily conferred, and firmly persuaded that it is our duty to bear testimony on this solemn occasion without partiality, do in the presence of Almighty God testify that we know of no impediment on account of which the Right Reverend Santosh Marray ought not to be acceded to the office, the holy office. We do, moreover, jointly and severally declare that we believe that the Right Reverend Santosh Marray to have been duly and lawfully elected, and to be of such sufficiency in learning and of such soundness of faith, and of such godly character as to be able to exercise the office of a bishop to the honor of God and the edifying of the church, and to be a wholesome example to the flock of Christ. Given this 14th day of June 2016, Kevin M. Cross, President of the Standing Committee. It is further stated, I hereby certify that the above canonical testimony was signed by a constitutional majority of the convention of the Diocese of Easton, meeting in special session at Trinity Cathedral, Easton, Maryland, on the 11th day of June, 2016, signed Nancy M. Dick, Secretary of Convention. June 16, 2016, Certificate of Ordination. This is to certify that according to the Recorder of Ordinations, Santosh Kumar Marray was received as priest from the Diocese of Bahamas on September 10, 2003 by Bishop Stephen H. Jekko for the Diocese of Florida. He was appointed as Assistant Bishop of the Diocese of Alabama on November 27, 2012 by the House of Bishops. The Church Pension Fund, in its capacity as Recorder of Ordinations, signed Felicia Diaz.
Certificate of Consents of Standing Committees. I hereby certify that consents have been received from the standing committees of 84 dioceses to the installation investiture of the Right Reverend Santosh K. Marray to be Bishop Diocesan of the Diocese of Easton. Signed, Kevin M. Cross, President of the Standing Committee.
The consents of the bishops. Be it known by all the people of God that 94 bishops, being a majority of the bishops having jurisdiction in this church, have consented to the election of Santosh Kumar Marray and to his status in the House of Bishops as Bishop of Easton, being 1,072nd bishop in the American succession. Diane Jardine Bruce, Secretary of the House of Bishops.
My brother, please reaffirm your declaration.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, I, Santosh Marray, chosen bishop of the church in the Diocese of Easton, solemnly declare that I do believe the Holy Scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the Word of God, and to contain all things necessary to salvation. And I do solemnly engage to confirm to the discipline, doctrine, discipline, and worship of the Episcopal Church.
Brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, you have heard testimony given that Santosh Marray has been duly and lawfully elected to serve as a bishop in the Diocese of Easton. You have been assured of his suitability and that the church has approved him for this sacred responsibility. Will you uphold Santosh as Bishop of the Diocese of Easton?
We will.
The scriptures tell us that our Savior Christ spent the whole night in prayer before he chose and sent forth his 12 apostles. Likewise, the apostles prayed before they appointed Matthias to be one of their number. Let us, therefore, follow their examples and offer our prayers to Almighty God as we recognize Santosh for the work to which we trust the Holy Spirit has called him.
Spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a blessing upon all human labor and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, Teresa of Avila, whose feast we keep today, the holy apostles Peter and Paul, Augustine of Canterbury, Thomas Becket, Julian of Norwich, Harriet Tubman, and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you,
be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, by your Holy Spirit, you moved Teresa of Avila to manifest to your church the way of perfection. Grant us, we pray, to be nourished by her excellent teachings and enkindle within us a keen and unquenchable longing for true holiness. Through Jesus Christ, the joy of loving hearts, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God forever and ever.
Amen.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up. Things which had grown old are being made new. And that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. Strangers shall stand and feed your flocks. Foreigners shall till your lands and dress your vines. But you shall be called priests of the Lord. You shall be named ministers of our God. You shall enjoy the wealth of the nations, and in their riches you shall glory, because their shame was double, and dishonor was proclaimed as their lot. Therefore they shall possess a double portion. Everlasting joy shall be theirs, for I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Put your trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on its riches. Take delight in the Lord, and he shall give you your heart's desire. Commit your way to the Lord and put your trust in him, and he will bring it to pass. He will make your righteousness as clear as the light, and your just dealing as the noonday. The mouth of the righteous utters wisdom, and their tongue speaks what is right. The law of their God is in their heart, and their footsteps shall not falter.
A reading from the letter to the Ephesians, third chapter. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that, according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Alleluia, 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 Alleluia. If you continue in my word, says Jesus, you will know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus said to his disciples, "As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Michael, bishop in the Church of God, the clergy and people of the Diocese of Easton, trusting in the guidance of the Holy Spirit, have chosen Santosh Marray to be a bishop and chief pastor, yeah. Y'all took my friend. I've been told three times since I've been here that your loss, speaking to me, your loss is our gain. And I know we're here to celebrate your gain, and I'm happy about that. I just don't want y'all to lose sight of the fact that it is our loss. We love this man that y'all have chosen to be your bishop, and we're real proud of Santosh and Lynn and their family. And we wish them every blessing. And I miss you, brother. Every time we do an ordination, every time we do something like this, we come to that wonderful prayer. This is one of my favorite prayers. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church. When I was ordained a deacon, only 35 short years ago, I was reading over the service the night before just to make sure that I had kind of a sense of what was going to happen. And in my terror, and in my panic, and in my almost dyslexic eyes, the next line was, "Your whole church, that wonderful and scared mystery." And what I want to tell you is, it's time for us to stop being scared. It's time for us to start being sacred. It's time for us to do what we say we're going to do and share the good news of the love of God in Jesus our Lord. We have been scared for a while, and now it's time to get past that. Before I really start, I just want to give y'all one more chance. Are you sure about this? All right. Well, I was afraid you were going to say that. You know he talks funny. You understand that. And I've been around when he talks a lot. He's a foreigner. You know that. So down in Alabama, when we're all concerned about Auburn and Roll Tide, Santosh is over there watching cricket. He ain't from around here, we say. Will you uphold Santosh as Bishop of the Diocese of Easton?
We will.
All right. Well, I'm going to hold you to it. And if I hear that you're not, I'm going to come knock some heads together up here. About 4.5 years ago, we had the investiture of the brand new Bishop of Alabama. Our friend Henry Parsley was there to hand the stick to the next bishop. We had a big parade just like this. We had a shorter and better sermon. The choir was lovely. The place was packed. And after it was all over, I, being the new Bishop of Alabama, went back to the back somewhere and was shaking hands and hugging people. And I'd taken my glasses off, like I do sometimes. And I saw that 8 or 10 people down the line, there was an old priest coming my way. And I was trying to squint and figure out, no, he's not from Alabama. His hair was gray to white. His black shirt was mostly still gray. And I realized that he was a priest that I knew when I was a kid in Mississippi. In fact, when I was on summer staff of our summer camp there, Camp Braddon Green, he was my boss for 2 summers. And I was touched to see him. I had on my big hat and all the robes, and I was carrying the stick and very official looking. And he came up and looked me up and down and said, "Well, I never saw this coming." And then he said, "You've come a long way from the Canton, Mississippi jail." And you know, I had forgotten that story. or tried to repress it. In the summer of 1975, I was on the permanent staff, the staff that stayed there for the whole time. We used to end most of the sessions with a spook house. I guess we like being scared. It was my 3rd year on staff. We were actually getting pretty good at it. We had this big house that kind of creaked if you left it alone. And it was sort of creepy, and a lot of people thought it was haunted, and I never stayed there, but one time overnight all by myself, the camp director would tell all the children some spooky story, and then they would come upstairs in little groups. And the people on the permanent staff, we were the coolest of the cool, we had our costumes worked out and we had our routines worked out. It didn't have to make sense, you just had to scare people. My friend Cliff had arranged it so that he had a harness of rope that he actually sat in, but it looked like it was around his neck. And he would kind of do this until you got too close and he would go, "Wah!" My friend, this was right after The Exorcist came out. Y'all remember The Exorcist? My friend Dina wore nothing but a sheet, really nothing but a sheet, and her hands and face were painted kind of a pea soup green. She didn't jump out and scare you, she just stood too close to you and kind of creeped you out. And I had a dull axe and had some jeans that had been cut off below the knee, and the girls would use their mascara to paint stitches all over my face. It looked like I'd been put together by a committee. And my job was to scare them out the rest of the way so we could get ready for the next little group. Well, this one time, my friend Miles called and said, "I'm going to come down overnight. Let's have a party." It doesn't take a whole lot to get 6 or 7 college kids to throw together a party. Miles had been on staff for several sessions before. He couldn't be there that week because he was at football practice. He played defensive end for Mississippi State. Not as tall as me, but much more solid. And we decided that we would have a party after the spook house. After the spook house was over, we would take off all our makeup and put on regular clothes and go into Canton, Mississippi, 11 miles away, and buy some party supplies. Now, the legal age for party supplies back then was 18. I was 19. We're okay. So we were going to go in town and get some bean dip and chips. You know. And then we thought, wouldn't it be cool to have Miles in the spook house? Because he's an intimidating specimen all by himself. And we knew that every year we did this, the campers were building up an immunity, so that they knew that I was the axe man, and they knew that Cliff was hanging from the ceiling, and they knew that Dina would stand too close. But if we could dress Miles up, they would not know who it is. So he came. He's really a good-looking guy. The girls on staff volunteered to put makeup all over his body. And when the campers came, they came up in little groups, and they saw there's Cliff hanging from the ceiling, and there's Dina with a green makeup, and there's Key trying to run us out of here with an axe. And who is that scary man with blood all over his face and down his neck? And we did a great job, and they were really scared. And while we were still patting ourselves on the back, the director of the session came and said, "You have to come and visit every cabin, because you have scared these little people to death, and bring Miles." So we went to all 8 cabins and explained to them, "We're just who we are, and this is my friend Miles, and this is just makeup," and wasn't that fun? I'm not sure why we ever thought that was fun, but we did. And by the time we went to all 8 cabins, we were concerned that the store that sold bean dip and chips might be closing. And we still had 11 miles to go, and somebody suggested, I hope it was somebody else suggested, that we didn't have to take off our makeup. We don't have to change clothes, it'll be an adventure. And so 5 of us got in Dina's Volkswagen Beetle Bug, and one was Miles in the back seat with the girl I was dating at the time. And I was in the front seat, and I'm not sure how it all worked out, but we got there just in time to see the store that sold bean dip and chips closing and the man turning off the lights and locking the door. And we were mightily disappointed, because you can't have a party without party supplies, you know. And then somebody recalled that there was another store in town on the other side of the tracks that also sold bean dip and chips. This is Mississippi, 1975. We didn't go on the other side of the tracks very often, but you have to have party supplies. And so we went over to that store, and they were still open, and Miles and I got out. to buy the supplies, bean dips and chips, 2 cases of ice cold bean dips and chips. And when we were coming out, we saw that Dina had somehow found 3 oranges that hadn't been squished by all these people sitting in her Volkswagen and was entertaining the gathering crowd by juggling. And we all thought that was good fun until the police car rolled up with lights flashing. He had gotten a call about disturbance of the peace on the other side of the tracks. He was young and sincere and really quite nervous. My friends all came together and decided that I should be the one to go talk to him. And so I approached him in my spook house costume and makeup with a face put together by a committee. And I held out my hand and said, "Hi, I'm Keith Sloan." He was not impressed. And then before I didn't want it to kind of go too far away and us get in any trouble, so I said, "We work for a church group." That didn't help a bit. He wanted to see our license and registration. He wanted to see our IDs. Most of us didn't have our IDs. And that's when we found out that it wasn't really Dina's car. After all. But that she was pretty sure her brother knew where it was the whole time. And that Dina didn't have a driver's license anymore. And that's when the young, sincere police officer thought that it would be a good thing for us to go to the Canton City Police Station and make a telephone call. And I called the priest who was in that town. It's about 1 o'clock in the morning on Sunday morning. His wife answered the phone. She was not amused and handed the phone to my friend Cecil, who said, "I'll be there in a minute." He said, "Don't go anywhere." Yeah. I promised we wouldn't. And he got there and he talked to the policeman and worked it all out and put us all in his car and drove us back to camp. Not a word was spoken until we got out and he said, "We will talk about this tomorrow." And we did. Well, he did. We just said, "Yes, sir," a lot. Now skip ahead 31 years. Gosh. 41 years. And here's this priest coming up the aisle of the Cathedral Church of the Advent in downtown Birmingham, Alabama, to congratulate me on becoming Bishop Diocesan. And he said, "I never saw this coming." And you know, neither did I. But people like Cecil and other priests of the church and other lay people of the church told me when I was a kid that what we ought to do is offer ourselves into the love and service of our Lord, and somehow or another I believed them. And so I put myself in God's hands a long time ago. And somehow or another became a bishop in God's church. Weird. And now you have called a little boy from Guyana who has offered himself into the love and service of our Lord Jesus and called him to be the Bishop of Easton and told us several times that you will uphold him in this ministry. And I know you will. This service is not really about Santosh. This service is really about all of us. I know that Santosh is a good bishop. I've seen it and felt it and heard it for 4 years, and I'm grateful to God and to Santosh. I know he's going to be a good bishop for the Diocese of Easton, and I know he can't do it by himself. Y'all know he's going to mess up. Do you know that? He's going to say something you don't like. He's going to make some decision that ruffles feathers. Every bishop, every priest, every layperson makes decisions that ruffle somebody's feathers. And your job then is to uphold him in this ministry. And there will be a moment coming up before all that long when he preaches a good long sermon, even longer than this one. Imagine that. And you'll be looking at your watch and wondering what time the football game starts. And I want to remind you that you have promised to uphold him in his ministry. We are called to offer ourselves into the love and service of Jesus. Not just the bishops, not just the priests, not just the deacons. I'm talking to you. Yes, you. I'm going to pause a little bit so you can squirm a little bit and start kind of putting together your defense that God might be calling you to do something. I'm too old. I'm not old enough. I'm setting my ways. Lord, we're all setting our ways. I don't have the education. I'm too smart. And there is that terrible thing I did that one time. You know what I'm talking about. I know I'm kind of a little too close to you here. But I want you to know that Jesus sees through all that and calls you. Doesn't care whether you're old or young or near or far or white or black or anything else. It's time for us to stop being scared and start being sacred. It's time for us to love each other in the name of Jesus Christ and share that love with everybody who comes close. It's time for us to celebrate with joy and hope so that we shine the light of Christ as a beacon to the world. So where will the Diocese of Easton be 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 30 years from now? Where will you be? You young people, you old people, you good-looking people, all of you people, where will you be? I tell you, I don't know. But you are called to offer yourself. All your gifts, all your weaknesses, all the things you're good at, all the things that you're not interested in, offer yourself into the love and service of our Lord. Hoist your sail into the breeze of the Holy Spirit and see where it takes you. There is no limit to what the Holy Spirit of God can do among people of goodwill who offer ourselves into the love and service of our Lord. And if God can take a kid out of the rice fields in Guyana, if God can take a boneheaded kid put together by a committee out of the Canton, Mississippi police station and make us bishops, there's no limit to what God can do with you. So, will you uphold Santosh as bishop of the Diocese of Easton?
We will.
May God bless you and keep you and blow among you and ruffle your hair and help you to love each other as Christ loved us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
My brother, the people have chosen you and have affirmed their trust in you by acclaiming your election. A bishop in God's holy church is called to be one with the apostles in proclaiming Christ's resurrection and interpreting the gospel, and to testify to Christ's sovereignty as Lord of lords and King of kings. You are called to guard the faith, unity, and discipline of the church, to celebrate and to provide for the administration of the sacraments of the new covenant, to ordain priests and deacons, and to join in ordaining bishops, and to be in all things a faithful pastor and wholesome example for the entire flock of Christ. With your fellow bishops, you will share in the leadership of the church throughout the world. Your heritage is the faith of patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and those of every generation who have looked to God in hope. Your joy will be to follow him who came, not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. I ask you now to reaffirm the promises made when you were ordained a bishop.
Will you accept this call and fulfill this trust in obedience to Christ?
I will obey Christ and will serve in his name.
Will you be faithful in prayer and in the study of Holy Scripture, that you may have the mind of Christ?
I will, for he is my helper.
Will you boldly proclaim and interpret the gospel of Christ, enlightening the minds and stirring up the conscience of your people?
I will, in the power of the Holy Spirit.
As a chief priest and pastor, will you encourage and support all baptized people in their gifts and ministries? Nourish them from the riches of God's grace. Pray for them without ceasing, and celebrate with them the sacraments of our redemption.
I will, in the name of Christ, the shepherd and bishop of our souls.
Will you guard the faith, unity, and discipline of the church?
I will, for the love of God.
Will you share with your fellow bishops in the government of the whole church? Will you sustain your fellow presbyters and take counsel with them? Will you guide and strengthen the deacons and all others who minister in the church?
I will, by the grace given me.
Will you be merciful to all, show compassion to the poor and strangers, and defend those who have no helper?
I will, for the sake of Christ Jesus.
Santosh, through these promises, you have committed yourself to God to serve his church in the office of Bishop of Easton. We therefore call upon you, chosen to be a guardian of the church's faith, to lead us in confessing that faith.
We believe in one God.
We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker
of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
After the hymn, we're going to this.
fall. Go ahead.
I'll make sure you don't fall.
Yeah, thank you.
You're fine.
Yeah.
Father, all hearts are open. Fill, we pray, the heart of this your servant, whom you have chosen to be the Bishop of Easton, with such love of you and of all the people, that he may feed and tend the flock of Christ, and exercise without reproach the high priesthood to which you have called him, serving before you day and night, in the ministry of reconciliation, declaring pardon in your name, offering the holy gifts, and wisely overseeing the life and work of the church. In all things, may he present before you the acceptable offering of a pure and gentle and holy life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit the honor and power and glory in the church, now and forever.
Amen.
May God, who anointed the Christ with the Holy Spirit at his baptism, anoint and empower you to bring good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, to set free those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord.
Amen.
My brother, you have been recognized as a bishop of the church and as bishop of this diocese. Now I, Michael Curry, presiding bishop, and with the consent of those who have chosen you, do recognize you, Santosh Marray, as Bishop of Easton, with all the temporal and spiritual rights and responsibilities that pertain to that office, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Yes.
Santosh, receive these vestments, the garments of humility. May our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light," give you grace so to help others to bear the burdens of this life, that your ministry may be assigned to all people of the generosity and gentleness of the kingdom that is to come. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Where does it go? Give it to them so they can present it.
come. Make it right. No, you just be a glad.
Do you want to do it over, Jane? You hold this. Let me open it. Wait a second. Wrong page. Page before. We're just going to read what they read like this.
Santosh, receive these vestments, the garments of humility. May our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light," give you grace so to help others to bear the burdens of this life, that your ministry may be a sign to all people of the generosity and gentleness of the kingdom that is to come. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Santosh, receive this pectoral cross, the sign of our salvation. May Christ give you grace. What's wrong with me? To deny yourself, take up your cross and follow him, that you may meet him when he comes in glory. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
You did good. You did good.
Santosh, receive this ring as a sign of fidelity, and with love and faith, defend God's people. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Santosh, my brother, receive this staff, the sign and symbol of your pastoral ministry. May you always be on the move, keeping watch over the whole flock of which the Holy Spirit has anointed you a shepherd. Encourage the faithful, restore the lost, care for all, and build up the body of Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Santosh, receive the Holy Scriptures. Feed the flock of Christ committed to your charge. Guard and defend them in his truth, and be a faithful steward of his holy word and sacraments.
Amen.
Amen.
Ingram, Amanda, Ariana, and Tenille.
Ariana and Tenille.
Why don't you all come in a minute? You all come in a minute. There you go. Come, my dear, come. Sing your song, child. Sing your song. Good. Come on, baby.
I'm sorry, we have to wait for the most important person.
I want to say meet your new bishop, but meet his grandchild. Meet your new bishop. Talk about stealing the show. Wow. And you do the piece. Oh, Jesus. Oh, no, please. She turned. She twirled.
say whatever, you're the bishop now.
Could you please be seated before I say the piece?
Keith, you're right, Doc.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all for coming out. Thank you, the Diocese of Easton, for letting me come play with you in God's, in the land of pleasant living, as it's called, but play with some level of dignity and kingdom building, if that is it. Thank you, Presiding Bishop, my good friend. Long before they gave you this title, we've been friends.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And thank you. Thank you, Henry. Thank you, Key. And those are Alabama folks, so I owe a lot to them. Thank you, my fellow brothers. Thank you, Bud, my number 10. I'm number 11. Thank you, everyone. And also to Dan Daniels, wherever he might be, because he gave me back my episcopal ministry by making me an assisting bishop in his diocese when I had nothing to do after I came back from Seychelles, 1 year of hard life. So he's truly a brother. I know I was the third bishop of Seychelles and now the 11th bishop of Easton, you know. I might be the first bishop in the Anglican Communion to be elected a bishop in the Eastern Hemisphere and the Western Hemisphere in one lifetime.
Right.
This is rather unusual. So I thank God every day. I love Jesus as my Lord and Savior. There's not a moment in my life that I don't talk with him and I don't challenge him to challenge me. 45 years ago, the young boy, a friend of mine in my little village, as a Hindu, growing up in a Hindu family, and this friend of mine, Ronald, taught me how to plant rice, didn't know much. Did a lot of rice farming, and rice farming wasn't mechanized. You sinking in deep mud with lots of heavy bag on your backs and fertilizer where you not did it with machine, you did it with hand, and you're sinking in mud. And you're walking miles after miles in knee deep and more water. And so he taught me how to plant rice, and he was a Christian at a small Anglican church in the village of mainly Hindus and Muslims, and I was a Hindu from Hindu family, and he said to me, come follow me to my church. And I certainly had a friend responding to the generosity of another friend. I followed him, and those words, come follow me to my church, have been words to which that I have used all over the world to bring people to Jesus Christ. There's no greater evangelistic words than come follow me to Jesus Christ. They are life-changing words. And I am here because those words changed my life. And I have changed, in the power of the Holy Spirit, thousands of people's lives all over the world by bringing them to Jesus Christ. And I continue to do that and will continue to do that every day of my life. So I want to thank Easton for letting me come here. Thank the Diocese of Alabama for, my gosh, Key, you're a real elder brother. And I'm supposed to have a friend here named Chuck Weyerhauser. Is he here? I don't know what happened to him. He was coming from Montana. Well, so I can't tell the story. But I want to thank, this is my family, my sister and my brother and his children, my sister and her children, my niece, eldest niece, flew in from London to be here, and my sisters, and those are my cousins, Nadira and her family, and Charles and his family, and Godfrey, my brother-in-law and his family, they drove in from New York all night last night to be here this morning. I want to thank you very, very, very much for being here. It means a lot to me. And so, and my brother-in-law, the big brother-in-law, Gapi, just raise your hand, friend. Yeah, and his children and her children there, my nieces and grandnephews. Tell you the truth, thank you all for driving all night to be here. And thank you all for coming again. I mean, some of the words, I'm a man of many words, and I am losing words today.
We know, Father.
You know, I have Bill Lester here. Bill Lester preached at my consecration, ordination and consecration of the Bishop of Seychelles in 2005, the 4th of April, 2005. So, Bill, good to see you. He's as old as God, so... So thank you. And all those who are looking via the internet, as the service has been streamed live through the Diocese of Easton and Alabama, thank you for watching. Hope you're inspired by this service. And as we continue, may God bless all of you and bless us in the Diocese of Alabama. But before I do that, you see that priest there? That's my bishop in Guyana, Charles Davison. Charles, raise your hand, please. Before I go that, Bishop Charles was at my consecration in Seychelles. And I was at his in March in Guyana when I went home. And that priest did. William, could you stand? And I owe being here to him because William came to my little church for his honeymoon, spending his honeymoon in their guest house, and asked to celebrate the Eucharist in my little church. And I was the one to prepare the altar on a Wednesday afternoon, and he said to me, "Would you want to be a priest?" I said, "Well, yes. I was thinking about it, but they said I couldn't go this year." And he said, "Well, come along to Georgetown. I'll take you to see the Archbishop, Alan Knight." He took me, and Alan Knight sent me off. I went to him in July of 77 and was at Codrington at the end of October of 77, because William was the one who took me to the Archbishop and said, "Here you are. Send him off."
Wow.
I wouldn't have been here, to be honest. I wouldn't have been. So what I'm saying is that there are so many people who have made this possible. This is not my thing. This is a collaborative effort of all good people and God's people who listen to God, who have singled me out to be somebody in God's church. And they listened to the Lord, and they invited me on board to this faith of Christianity from another faith. These things don't happen every day, and I'm thank God that I'm part of that magic that the Lord Jesus Christ is doing on this blessed, blessed day. And I'm thank God for the Episcopal Church, and I thank God for receiving me. So, to all of you who didn't say anything to, you know I love you, right?
Yeah.
I'm lost for words.
He's having a lot of words.
Yeah. Go figure that. Hear the words of our brother Paul. We are the body of Christ. By the one Spirit, we are all baptized into one body and make the drink of the same Spirit. Let us then pursue the things that make for peace and build up the common life. My beloved, in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us stand and share the peace.
Peace be with you, brother.
Peace.
Peace be with you,
brother.
Golly, it's nice to be with you.
It's great to be with you.
You look really good.
I'll see you back at home.
Thank you.
Please keep praying, Henry. Lord knows. Please. Oh, you thought I was doing way back.
Peace, everyone.
Peace be with you.
I'll say peace with all of you. Everybody. Thank you very much. Peace, Dean.
Joyful, excited, ecstatic greetings of your brothers and sisters who are the Episcopal branch of the Jesus Movement. We are so happy for you. As long as you're feeling good, keep feeling good when you dig into that wallet. Yeah, you got Episcopalian, didn't you? Generous as possible for the offertory. The money raised will be for the bishop's discretionary fund for pious, charitable, and safe uses. God bless you, God keep you, and you keep on.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us. Fragrant offering and sacrifice to Almighty God.
Thank you. All things come from you, O Lord, and of your own we give you. Blessed be God forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because in the obedience of your saints, you have given us an example of godly of righteousness, and in their eternal joy, a glorious pledge of the hope of our calling. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him, you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him, you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon Send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, Peter, Paul, Barnabas, Teresa, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by him, and in him, and with him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, with our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray, Our Father. Words of our beloved brother Paul, we break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread and are made to drink of the same cup. Alleluia, Christ our Passover. They're going to sing this. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for us. Feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
join us.
Please join us me in the post-communion prayer. Almighty Father, we thank you
for feeding us with the holy food of the body and blood of your Son, and for uniting us through him in the fellowship of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for raising up among us faithful servants for the ministry of your word and sacraments. We pray that Santosh may be to us an effective example in word and action, in love and patience, and in holiness of life. Grant that we with him may serve you now and always rejoice in your glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
1 minute to thank all those who prepared this auditorium for this service as we are getting ready to close it. And I want to thank all those who worked so hard with the arrangements, with the planning, the transition committee, Sandy and her team in the Baltic Hill, and everyone else who did a remarkable job. And we couldn't have done this afternoon without your invaluable and precious, precious time and energy in making all of this happen. And one thing else, let's talk about a friend who, and this is good, Bishop Michael, you like this story. That gentleman there, his name is Chuck Weilhauser Charles. He flew in from Montana. We have been friends for over 20 years. When I was parish priest in Abaco, he bought a house by the beach. And I always walked the street, and anybody knew who came to the resort, I would go to their house and welcome them to the neighborhood and invite them to the small Episcopal, well, it wasn't a church, it was a building there. We had just 4 members I inherited, and he came to the church, he and his wife, they came to the church, and he was able to encourage the other homeowners from the USA and England and Germany who have second homes in that resort to come to the little church. And we grew from 4 members to 120 in 2 years. and he engineered the construction of the church for over $500,000 without or debt free. And for the past 20-something years, he has supported my ministry all over the world. His footprints of generosity stretches from Seychelles to Madagascar to Africa, because I'll say, Chuck, I got some knee down here. And he will say, how much you need, Father Marray or Bishop Marray then? And here with the money getting into where it was supposed to go and doing great work. And he still continues to do that work. And I must say this, when I was called to be Bishop of Seychelles, I had my children in university and didn't know how could I take this call. And he said to me, Father Marray, you go, I will handle that. And he gave them scholarship with his nonprofit. And our children are educated today because of his generosity. And he's here today. He's still working to bring people to Christ the way I brought him to Christ. And I realize that authentic evangelism is contagious. Authentic evangelism is contagious. When you do it from the heart, people catch the fire. And he is a testament to authentic evangelism and what he has done for me and my family. Thank you, Chuck.
You are blessed.
Put the helmet on. Of salvation.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
The Maker of heaven and earth.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
From this time forth.
and the blessing, mercy, and grace of God Almighty, and the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you, and your loved ones, and even upon those who may not love you this day, now and forevermore.